This is models of argumentation, identifications in the Fisher versus University of Texas trial at the Supreme Court level. So a statement of the problem is to look at argumentation, because not only is it important to study the issues that eventually do affect policy levels, but to also study the models of argumentation of how those issues are presented, especially when it comes to trials. So to see which of those are used as tools of persuasion and as a strategy for influencing policy decision making. And then by doing that, we'll try to anticipate the effects of such a legal case like Fisher to try and illuminate what possible outcomes would be. So the process, we'll try and speed through this. Qualitative discourse analysis is using a lot, working a lot with assumptions, and then seeing how much of the arguments and everything else that follows always trace back to those assumptions, what is prioritized, what is privileged, so forth. Heuristic is in this merely, not necessarily situational, but experience. So how much is leveled in experience itself? So we'll be going through the actual cases, both plaintiff and defendant in Fisher UT, at what level. First, it had to pass through the Western District of Texas, and then it had to go to the Fifth Circuit, which goes off the districts of Texas, Mississippi, and Louisiana. Then it had to pass all the way to the Supreme Court. So the text that I'm going to be using as primary are the ones filed at Supreme Court, because the argument has in fact changed as they go up higher and higher. Also, I'm going to be looking at various theories that will be applied to those models, to those arguments themselves, to see which of them are applicable, which are pros and cons, and so forth. So our three research questions. What are the models of argumentation from philosophy that are potentially applicable to the study of argumentation in Fisher versus UT? The models of argumentation that are evident through the discourse and legal filings of the plaintiffs and defendants? And what are possible implications once you've identified those argumentation models? Ethical decision-making. What are those three theories that I'm talking about from ethical decision-making or philosophy? So, a theory of distributive justice is best thought of as providing moral guidance for the formation of public policies that affect the distribution of economic benefits and burdens in a society. That's what's being allocated, that's what's being distributed, burdens and benefits. So the three theories that I've chosen would be John Rawls' difference principle, the desert-based principles, which is like just desserts, and utilitarianism, which I'll also explain. The criteria that I chose, or why I chose those specific three, was that they were all global theories of justice. By global, meaning in contrast to local. So rather than dealing with a system or a structure to deal with, let's say, pockets of society, it wants to go through the actual system as a whole. Society, the overall plan. In order to do so, instead of having various principles of how to distribute, how to allocate, each of the three has one chosen single one that is distributed to everyone. So, understanding our first research question, we'll get to the three models, but at the end of the day, the three different principles, desert-based principles, and utilitarianism, each are the three that will be at the center of our discussion. A sacrifice of basic liberties, which I was saying, the legitimacy of certain desert bases, and the maximization of social utility. And then we'll get into the pros and cons of each theory. So we'll speed through this. John Rawls' difference principle. Basic liberties, least advantage, and the difference principle. So I'm happy to go after Daniel and also Joe, because you've already heard terms like marginalized, at risk. Rawls used a rather different term, which is least advantage. Least advantage what? It actually comes down to economic class. So strict egalitarianism calls for the allocation of equal material goods to all members of society. Distribution is equal despite where they stand economically or what powers they hold in society and so forth. Rawls is saying that there's actually a difference. You can't allocate them all the same because they're not the same. You have to make a difference when it's appropriate. So it permits diverging from strict equality as long as the inequalities in question would make the least advantaged economic class in society materially better off than they would be under strict equal distribution. So if they could benefit more than receiving a straight up equal distribution, then let's go for that. But at what cost? It It serves as a model for catering to the means, or they're catering to the disadvantaged, but not in any way that would sacrifice the basic liberties of others. What are those basic liberties? You know, liberty of conscience, political liberties, their right to vote and run for office, freedom of speech, you know, freedom of the press, association, personal property, and the one the biggest for the case that we'll discuss later, the rights and liberties covered by the rule of law, freedom from arbitrary arrest, search and seizure, 14th Amendment, and definitely be in there. So you can cater to the least advantage given an unequal distribution, but not at the sacrifice of others, of these liberties that they hold dear. Desert-based principles, like just deserts, is a three-part relation involving a subject, an object, and a basis. So there is a deserving subject, there is a deserved object, and the desert basis is why they deserve it. So X deserves A over from Y in virtue of B. So if you had something stolen, let's say, I deserve to get that object back from whoever stole it because it is rightfully mine, because it is my personal property, or something like that. Advocates of desert-based principles argue that some may deserve a higher level of material goods because of their hard work and contribution, even if those unequal awards are not to improve their situation as a disadvantage. What that means is if you don't fall into the least advantaged category, can you still receive an unequal distribution because of your hard work and contributions? Desert-based principles would argue yes. There are then two ways to argue against a desert basis. The first would be the merely factual reason that that particular quality that constitutes a desert basis is not possessed by X, whoever it is that's in question. I didn't know this, but when someone informed me that some people would go to IHOP and other restaurants and get a veteran's discount, a way to tackle that is not to attack the basis itself, but if they possess it, are you in fact a veteran, and should you be getting that discount? The second one would then attack the quality itself. This is not a legitimate basis for deserving something. So, for feminist arguments that would argue, for years it was argued that men should be paid more because they're actually supporting a family, they're responsible more, their money would actually go to other places, to which feminists would argue, no, that is not a legitimate basis for being paid more because, not necessarily that they don't possess that quality, but is that a legitimate basis? Are men actually supporting more? Do they deserve that more funds or a higher pay in order to account for that? Utilitarianism, the third one, it's all about social utility. What is it? It's a measurement which contributes to the society's total amount of welfare. And we'll get into the discrepancy between level and increment. So let's suppose you have two individuals, X and Y, who would both benefit from one unit of a scarce good. You can give that good to X if their initial level of welfare is lower than that of Y. Or you can give it to X if the increment in welfare will produce in X higher than the increment it will produce in Y. Now let's discuss an example. You have two students, one who's going for his bachelor's, another one going for his master's, and we have a scholarship to hand out. The one who's attaining a bachelor's is 1 year away from graduation. The one attaining a master's is 2 years away from graduation. Under a level of what would produce more welfare in a society, the master's would trump the bachelor's because the master's is higher than a bachelor's. Level-wise, he would produce more utility than a bachelor's. However, increment is the change that it would produce. There would be more opportunities available to the 1 year graduate or 1 year student or 1 year away from graduating student from obtaining the bachelor's than the opportunity of the master's student being 1 year further into his program. More opportunity based from achieving this versus achieving this. That's increment. So who does the scholarship go to? That's a debate. So speaking through this again, we have our assumptions, which all comes down to how justice is defined in the three theories, what is prioritized, and who is privileged. So, for justice, in the difference principle, you install polities to the greatest benefit of the least advantaged without sacrificing the basic liberties of others. What is prioritized are those liberties over that of equal power in society, which is not to say that it's not important, but that one clearly trumps the other in your pursuit. And who is privileged? Those of the least advantaged class. For the desert-based principles, you install policies to the greatest benefit of those who meet the qualifications. Now that the discussion comes between contribution, effort, and cost, what determines merit? What is prioritized? So, who deserves the raise at work? Is it middle-aged man who meets his quotas but not in a very fast time, normally has to stay after work in order to do so? Young stud, who is young and energized and is able to do it in far a shorter amount of time, maybe even surpass his quota even more? Or single mother, who actually costs and sacrifices more in order to obtain work? She doesn't have the energy of the young stud, and she doesn't have the time of the middle-aged man for various reasons. So, this is effort. He's putting in far more effort. That means he determines merit, or that warrants him merit. He is productivity, contribution. He is producing a lot more. She is cost. It sacrifices her, or she has to sacrifice a lot more in order to get it. So who deserves the raise? Again, that's really up for discussion. So who is privileged? Those with the opportunity to meet qualifications. So it's not merely that you have to meet the qualifications, you have to have the opportunity to meet one. So for instance, there's more opportunities when applying to undergrad if you do the subject test, like the SAT 2 subject test. But if you didn't know that, if you didn't have the funds, or if you didn't have access to them, you would not have the opportunity to meet those qualifications. Utilitarianism installs policies to improve the total amount of welfare. Again, we discussed what it prioritizes is level versus increment. And privilege, those capable of converting those goods into welfare. We'll fly through the pros and cons, because I am running out of time. But for the starting gate, not all of us start at the same position. It would be lovely if that were the case, but in the game of life, we actually start at different positions, so that it's not at all surprising when one of us may finish a lot earlier than the other. Desert-based principles don't seem to take that into account, or do seem to be sensitive to such a thing. I'm really running low. So I'll just go through quickly where these theories will be applied to Fisher versus UT. So, like I said, it's changed from each one. Rudder in 2003 made it effective for you to use race in the admissions as long as it was narrowly tailored. What does that mean? Means that it's not necessarily catering to one race in particular, but all races, and that it would be a holistic review, meaning of everyone's attributes, not just of race. Critical mass, how many do you need in order to obtain such a minority base? They can't be spokesmen of their own race. They have to be an adequate enough of them in order to interact, to contribute to the educational benefits. So, this is Fisher's argument. Critical mass was surpassed. You had enough minorities, you had enough of them, because as of now, I think blacks and Hispanics fall into over one-fifth of UT's enrollment. So, you have enough of them, you can stop. Over-inclusive plan. UT is already one of the best opportunities for Hispanic students, so just to include them as underrepresented proves that it's over-inclusive. There's no reason to keep using them. Racial balancing. Meaning that we're actually going towards the state. So what are the state demographics? We look at the enrollment, how many Hispanics are enrolled at UT, look at the state, how many Hispanics are used in the state of Texas, and try to measure those. Race-neutral alternatives, meaning that they did not give consideration to you. Why use race at all? Go back to desert-based principles and have them work for it, have them attain merit. So what I did was go through all of these and check off where they fall in under which of the three theories. What type of theory am I talking about when I make certain arguments? And then did the same thing for UT. So for instance, UT's one of the first arguments was that it's a holistic review. This is race. You have your personal achievement index of how they rate their students when they want them to enroll in their programs. You have special circumstances, and then you have race. So this is what they mean by it's a factor of a factor of a factor. Race is such a very small thing that what they're actually doing is determining merit in a different way. They're using desert-based principles. If you're talking about interracial diversity, That means that not only do I want blacks and Hispanics, I want different types of blacks and Hispanics. I don't want only Hispanics that are first generation. I don't only want Hispanics that only speak Spanish as a primary language. I don't only want Hispanics and so forth. Notice that that's not necessarily in a range of roles. I don't care about them because they're least advantaged. I care about them for what they can bring to my school, especially different types of them. That's a utilitarian argument. I am increasing social utility by having people like them in my program, not because I want to improve their circumstance, not because it's my duty to do it in society, and so forth. Also, with program diversity, critical mass has not been obtained because although we have significant of them, not all of them fall evenly in different programs. Are there evenly enough?